There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the spirit of the Lord.
There are sweet expressions.
There are sweet expressions on each face, and I know they feel the presence of the Lord.
Sweet Holy Spirit.
Sweet Holy Spirit. Sweet.
Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the name of the Lord. Praise him, O ye servants of the Lord. Ye that stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Sing praises unto his name, for it is pleasant. For I know that the Lord is great, and that our Lord is above all gods. Amen. Let us pray. Most loving, most merciful Father, we just want to thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that we can be in your house this morning. Father, we just want to lift up your name, glorify you, and magnify you. Father, we thank you for life, and we thank you for love. And as we give our hearts to you today, we pray, Father, that the blessings will come down. Thank you for loving us as we serve you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We want to thank the Lord this morning for enabling us to be in his courts today. Whatever the nature of your week was, whether it was a successful or a struggling one, you may have had a hard week or a happy week, God has safely brought you through. And the fact that you are seated here is a reason to give thanks. It is the songwriter John Newton who says, "Safely through another week, God has brought us through." And he makes this encouragement. He says, "Let us seek his blessings today, waiting in his courts. Let us sense his presence near each of us." Why God's presence? Because you and me know that in God's presence, there is fullness of joy. In God's presence, there is fullness of peace. There is fullness of love. What we may lack in material, God richly provides for us. My prayer is that as we worship today, as we fellowship, as we witness, we will all become rich in love, rich in faith, rich in relationships. I was thinking that the things that really matter in life cost £0. Did you know that? Think of love. Can you buy love? Priceless. Think of kindness. You know, unfortunately, The enemy has kept us so busy chasing raw deals, not the real deal. I don't know about you. Some of us are very obsessed with wealth, not health. With lust, not love. With gold, not God. With fame, not faith. With pleasure, not purpose. With pride, not peace. I pray that today, in God's presence, we will not settle for the counterfeit. Let me remind us that we come here not just to worship, but also to fellowship and to witness. And so, purpose to be with us for the whole day. Because after worship, at 1 o'clock, we have fellowship lunch. We'd love you to fellowship with us over lunchtime. And then in the afternoon at 3:30, we become an army of witnesses. And we go out to witness for Jesus. And we like to share what God is doing in our lives. So, and then at 5 o'clock, our young people have a program lined up for you. So really, it's a full day on offer for us. I want to take this opportunity to welcome our regular members and to appreciate that once again this Sabbath you could join us. If you're a member of Balaam, could you wave at your pastor, please? Could you please stand if you're a member of Balaam and turn to every other member of Balaam and give them a big hug, give their hug about today? Tell them that you love them because they are part of this big family. Now, I would like you to remain standing if you're a member of Balaam. Hello? If you're a member of Balaam, could you remain standing? Could you please walk to the people who are seated, who are visiting with us, and give them, you know, a double hug. Give them a special welcome.
As we greet each other, we're going to sing, "The Jesus in Me Loves the Jesus in You."
That has got me worried now. Did you hear what I said? That start has got me worried because there is great music coming. Guys, we want to thank you very much. By the way, did you find out the names of the people who are seated? Bala members, don't fail us. It isn't just a question of going over to hug them. We need to be able to sit next to them. If you're sitting with a family and there is visitors next to you and they are all by yourself, maybe this is a time to think of relocating where they are to just make them feel welcome here. So we would love to make them feel that we love them. So if you didn't get to know them, make an effort after the service to know who they are. Just a few announcements we want to bring to our attention. Next Sabbath is a very special Sabbath to us here at Balaam. We want to be able to do what is the foremost role of this place or our gathering here, and it is prayer. My house shall be called a house of what? Prayer. So next Sabbath is a Sabbath of prayer. From morning through to the evening, we have a prayer. And it is not just going to be praying about us, we also want to pray for our community. So we will have a normal program in the morning. Those of us who can, and we want to encourage as many of us as possible, have a light lunch so that your mind is focused at God and we can be able to have a discerning alertness of God's presence. So if you can half the amount of lunch you bring or have something different for us for that day, it will give us a lot. But something special we want to do between 5 and 9 p.m., we want to spend time in prayer for our community. And for us to do that, this afternoon we want to invite you to come and join us as we go out into the community. We want to knock at the doors of the community and make them aware that next Sabbath, between 5 and 9, we will have a prayer time for our community. And if they have any prayer requests, we would like to take those ones on. If you don't find anybody in the home you go, we'd like you to drop a card. It has a very simple message from your neighborhood prayer watch. Join us for a time of prayer at our Balaam church. And this is the time that we're going to be there. So we'll be dropping these cards in the community between 3:30 and 5 this afternoon. Please do join us as our PM team, and we'll be able to invite our community for that. We want to thank you very much as a leadership for your generous donation for the treatment of Leonie. Last Sabbath, we did a special collection for our sister who needs to go for treatment overseas. We collected £700. Amen? We like to make it 1,000. And so we want to open and make further invitation. If you would like to give any further donation, please see the pastor or the first elder. And that would be really appreciated. Department leaders are reminded we want to ready ourselves for a business meeting for next month. So next Sabbath, next week, please submit your reports to the church clerk in preparation for our next board. Those of you who came in, especially from the Women Ministry Department, as a Women Ministry leader has provided a survey. She's asking us to complete this survey, ladies in particular. And at the end, when we are finishing this, when we are concluding the service, please leave it, give it to the leader or any of the ushers. The School of Evangelism is continuing. We started last Sunday. We had a good turnout. We have spaces for 5 more people. And tomorrow, between 10 and 1, anybody who would like to join the School of Evangelism, there's a special catch-up session that has been designed. If you miss the first 2, then tomorrow is your last chance to be able to join with the rest of the team. So see the pastor today, and you'll be able to get an opportunity to know how to join in and what spaces are left. We want to thank God today in a special way because alongside with our regular service, we have Brother Isaac Kabaka and Rudo Mutiba, who would love to present their children to the Lord. So I want to, first of all, appreciate that they have chosen us at Balaam as the place where they would like to dedicate their children to the Lord. Brother Isaac and Sister Rudo follow the footsteps of many responsible parents and guardians who recognize and acknowledge that children are a gift of God entrusted to us for a time that we may raise them to know and love God. The baby dedication service that we conduct is adopted after the example of Jesus in Mark 10 and verse 13. Jesus said to his disciples, "Don't forbid the children to come to me, but let them come." And he took their hands and blessed them. So today, they are here to appreciate and give thanks to God for what God has done. So I'm going to invite them together with those extended family members who are here, if they could join us on the platform, please. I invite Brother Israel and Sister Ruda to come and present their children. I just want to take a moment to commend them for choosing to share their lives. When we receive life, it is very easy to choose not to share that life. And we live in a time where many consider, even when they are able, that sharing that life or creating new life is very inconveniencing. It's too much of a sacrifice. It's too stressful. But I've come to discover that where possible, parenting, whether biological or otherwise, enhances our experience and appreciation of God's character and action towards each of us. For me, parenting was the most life-transforming experience. It allowed me to see the best of myself and the worst of myself. It opened my eyes to see my dependence on other people, how I need other people in my life. And I pray that when God gives each of us an opportunity, whether biological or even as spiritual guardians, let us take our place and serve as parents. This church is a family. And we have many who come in our midst who may not have their biological parents. But you and me have a chance to step forward and be a spiritual guardian. Take advantage of that. Today, they want to give thanks to God for the health and the lives of their children. They want to commit themselves to God for His help to raise their children to love God. But they're also extending an invitation to us as a church, and saying to us, we would love you to play a part in the lives of our children. And that is where I hope that we will be able to be willing to come forward. But ultimately, we want to dedicate today both Alexander and Alicia to the Lord.
God has given us many gifts. Today we praise Him for giving us the gift of creating these new lives, and we dedicate them to Him. We thank God for the unique opportunity to raise our children up in God. Amen.
As God the Father gave us His Son for us, we bring our children this morning as a gift to Him. We ask God, special blessings of wisdom, understanding, and faith to be with us as we train them to know, love, and trust God. We ask for your support and encouragement as a church. God bless you.
Do we promise that we will be able to offer our support and encouragement? Should we show that by waving at them? You see that wave? It is an invitation for you to be able to take advantage and to use this commitment. We're going to invite Pastor Errol to do the prayer.
Church, I'd like to invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray. Our loving God, the Father of us all, the one who has given Alicia and Alexander their parents so that they can learn what it is to be patient and understanding and caring and compassionate, for them to understand a little bit of how it feels when you as God looks down upon us unruly and disobedient children as we are, and yet you love us. And so today we pray that a special blessing will come upon the parents as they seek to bring their children up in the fear and the knowledge of God. Help them to be understanding parents and caring parents. Help them today that this service will be a dedication of themselves to you, knowing that without that dedication, they cannot bring up Alexander and Alicia in the fear of God. But Father, help them to know that you are there for them at all times. May their children never seem to be in the way or trouble or problem children, but may they realize that these children are God's gift to them. They're loaned to them for a while, and that one day you're going to ask them to give an account of these children. And so I pray that you'll bless Alexandra and Alicia with health and strength, wisdom, understanding. Protect them in this world of troubles and sickness and disaster and all kinds of atrocities. Help them that through the power of your Spirit, they'll be protected and guided and guarded, and that their parents, their family members, their loved ones will see in them children who are just like Jesus, nurtured, loved, cared for, and living to serve you all the way. Father, I pray that you'll bless this church as the church supports them, as their community supports them, that they will indeed help them to grow up in the fear and the knowledge of God. And then, Lord, when time passes on into eternity, and when Jesus comes and calls for his people, and when he asks these parents for their children, may they proudly present them back to you, knowing that these are the heritage of the Lord, and we're just stewards caring for them. Thank you for blessing them. Thank you for providing for them. Thank you for blessing the parents and blessing all the family members gathered here today. And one day soon when you come, may we see you face to face and spend eternity with you as families, because we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Going to ask the supper school for the children. Is Sister Steph around? Okay. Just come and welcome them to supper school. That's all right. It's not used to being in this crowd. Just extend us to the supper school.
Okay. Oh, dear. Hello. Anybody want to join us in the baby room for Sabbath school? She'll be there.
Yeah.
Look, see? Hello. Welcome to Junior Sabbath School. It comes with a package. So whenever you can, please do join us, and we will try to ensure that we provide an environment where your children can come to know God, to know Jesus, and to sing.
Amen.
Okay, happy Sabbath again, everyone. This is one of my favorite times in the service. It's praise and worship time. I've decided to pick songs because I was sort of having one of those weeks where you think I'm not really in the best state of mind. But each and every time I would think of, oh, what am I going to do? I always had these songs ringing in my head. So I thought, this is, because I'm such a music person, I feel like God always communicates with me through music, and that's the best way I respond to it. So if you have had a week that has been tough and you don't understand what's going on, I hope these songs bring you some sort of peace and remind you that God chose you above everything else and He still loves you. Our first song is going to be Above All.
Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all one.
is going to be In Christ Alone. We're going to sing it a little bit different. We're going to sing one verse, and we're going to sing another verse, and we're going to put a chorus that I really love, and it says, On Christ the solid rock I stand. So we're going to sing a chorus in between the verses, and then we go to sing the last verse. Okay? Right. So first verse, we're going to sing another verse, a chorus, and then we're going to sing the last verse. So we're going to sing, In Christ alone, my hope is found.
Calls me home here in the past.
final song is going to be hymn 337, Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. Can we stand as we sing our final song? So we're going to start with this side first. They're going to sing the first verse.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever.
Everyone together now. Story, and we're going to sing He's Got the Whole World in His Hands. Sabbath. How are you? You're right. How are you doing? Not in the mood today, Micah? I know sometimes it's like that. But I wish you all a happy Sabbath. Now tell me, how was your half term?
It was funny.
Why was it funny?
Because Dad was making silly faces.
Oh, Dad always makes the good faces to make you laugh. What else? What did you get up to on your half term?
I like the motorbike just killed himself.
A motorbike? Oh, okay, I don't know this one, but maybe I'll see it later. Anyone else want to share what they got up to? You want to say something?
On the course.
Say that again, darling.
On the course.
Okay, you went for a course? Wow, you've got busy things going on. And that's your sister? Cousin, okay. Well, welcome to Children's Story, yes.
I played cricket at the
Play cricket at the park. Did you win? No? Well, well done for trying. You came second place. That's a good place to come. Football. Say that again. You got to speak a bit louder.
Football.
What did you do with the football?
Football.
You scored goals with the football. That sounds like a lot of fun. I'm glad you had some fun.
I played with my cousins and had fun.
Good, good. It sounds like you had a good time on half term. Anybody else? Well, welcome today. I hope by the end of the day you have more smiles on your faces, because guess what? It's the Sabbath day. We should be very happy today. Yeah? So my name's Alexa. I'm going to be telling you a story. The story I'm going to tell is based on... Yes, quickly.
I got a Spider-Man.
Okay, you'll show us your Spider-Man later. So we've got a story for you. And it's based on two scriptures. The first one is from Matthew chapter 22. And it's a bit of a passage, but I'm only going to read one verse. And it says from verse 40. And it says, love and treat your neighbor as yourself. Treat others as we would like to be treated. Now, have you heard this before? Some of you have, some of you haven't. Okay. So, and the next one is from Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. Love your enemies and pray for those who treat you badly. Did you hear that? Love your enemies. So don't just love the people who are nice to you, but love everyone, the good and the bad, and pray for those who treat you badly. Yeah? So that's what my story is based on today. So I want you to listen as I tell it. Okay, so there was a little girl, and her name was Sarah. Now, Sarah was different. She was different from all the other children in her school and in her class. Why was she different, do you think?
She was disabled.
She was disabled, okay. Any other ideas?
So no one didn't like her.
They didn't like her because she was different, yes.
She had no friends.
She had no friends.
I don't have friends to play with.
She didn't have any friends to play with because she was so different.
She had a different color skin tone.
She had a different coloured skin tone from everyone. These are all very good ideas. So yes, you're right. She wasn't quite disabled, but she didn't have any friends. She was different from everyone. She looked different. She had a different colour skin tone. Her lips were a bit bigger than everyone else's. She had a bigger nose. Maybe she didn't have the nicest clothes because she wasn't very rich. Her family weren't that rich. And what did you think the other children done to her?
Laughter.
They laughed at her, they made fun of her.
She bullied her. They bullied her.
Yes, you're quite right. They did bully her. And do you think that's a nice thing? How did you think she was feeling when they were being so mean to her?
Really sad.
Lonely.
She felt lonely, sad.
Really upset. And really, her went home.
Thank you for that. So yes, she felt very sad. She didn't have any friends to play with, very lonely. And she would cry. Sometimes she would go home. Say that again.
Unsafe.
She felt unsafe because they were bullying her. Yes. She would go home and she would cry. She didn't have any friends to play with. And this would happen all the time when she would go to school. So every day she would go to school and the children would pick on her. And she didn't have anybody to tell, no one to be her friend, no one to stand up for her. She was very, very sad. So it turns out that, just like you, there was half term. So there was no school, and she thought, yes, I'm finally free, I can be at home, and I wouldn't have to worry about it. But when it was half term, and she went outside to play in her garden, who did she see opposite her house?
The people that she didn't like.
Yeah, the bullies from school, she saw them. And in particular, there was this one big bully, the biggest of them all. His name was Terry. He was about 5'5" and he was only in year two. He was killer, he was massive. He's a beast. Yeah, he was big. And she was so scared. Yeah, well, he never used to hit her, but he used to make fun of her because she was different, remember? So she didn't know what to do. So she would maybe try and avoid seeing and making contact with him, but it turned out that it was her neighbor. He lived across the road from her. So what could she do? When she went out of her house to ride on her bike and her scooter, she would see his face and she would run inside and not want to come out, but her mum would say and her dad would say, it's time for you to go outside and play. You can't stay inside all day.
She should pray to Jesus.
It's a very good idea. She should pray to Jesus. What should she say to Jesus, do you think?
Please make no one bully me.
It's a very nice prayer. What else?
Please make sure no one makes in front of me.
Thank you for that, guys. So let's listen to the story. So as she was trying to play and be happy, she couldn't do that because, again, Terry was her neighbor and she was scared. So she would run back home and she would try to hide, but mom and dad would encourage her to keep going outside to play. So one day she was outside. She was playing by herself. All her other friends, well, the school children were playing together. And Terry was there, and Terry saw her. Now, Terry came up and was about to start calling her names and make fun of her, but she didn't try to run away. She thought, no, I'm going to be brave. I'm going to do what I'm doing, and I'm going to ignore them. Have you ever heard anyone say that when someone's being mean to you, ignore them? Does it work?
Yeah.
Think so?
Is that to me so my sister doesn't ignore me?
That's very good advice from Daddy. Sometimes you just have to ignore. You have to turn the other cheek. But this time, Terry was relentless. He kept on going and going and making fun of poor Sarah. And Sarah thought, you know what? What have I done? I can't help it. These things I can't change. I can't determine the color of my skin. I can't change the way my face looks. It's just how I am. So day after day, you know, they only have a week for half term, and she thought, well, I can't get away from Terry. He's going to be here all the time. So she just decided to put up with it. Now, Terry, this was on the Thursday. Terry and the other boys and girls from the school came running around the corner, and Sarah was wondering, why are they running? What's going on? But little did Sarah know, there was a dog that the children were making fun of and poking with a stick, and the dog had enough. And the dog was chasing them round the block, chasing, and big, big barks. Who can bark? I need a big bark. we need a deep one. Anybody with a woo? That's it, that kind of scary bark. So the dog was barking and it was chasing them. And Sarah wasn't scared of dogs like the other kids because she had dogs and she was quite friendly with animals. And she thought, this doesn't look like it's going to end very nicely. Now, Terry, he was big. I told you he was like 5'5", right? And he's in year two. So he was kind of big himself, and he couldn't keep up with the other children. They were running really quickly, and he was at the end. Well, yes, he was plump. So it turned out that there was a little something on the pathway, and he tripped. And when he tripped, He sprained his ankle and he fell on the floor and he couldn't run anymore, but the dog was coming. Remember, what's the dog sound like? Woo! That dog was chasing him. And Terry was looking at so petrified on the floor, and Sarah could see that it wasn't gonna end well at all. And Sarah thought, what should I do? Should I let that dog bite him? What do you think?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sarah was like, maybe he'll get his just desserts. He's been so mean to me, making fun of me all the time. Maybe this is God answering my prayers. What do you think?
No.
No, I don't think God would answer prayers like that. Do you think so? We'll see. We'll see how the story ends. So Sarah thought, maybe I should go and and help. So what she done, she had her toys that she was playing with. She had a ball, and she knew that dogs like to chase things. And maybe he wanted to chase Terry, but it wasn't a good idea. So she took her ball, And she ran across and she got the ball and she was showing it in front of the dog's face. And she was like trying to pretend to the dog to go and fetch it. So the dog got distracted from Terry and now wanted to chase the ball. And she threw the ball as fast and fast as she could. And the dog went and chased the ball instead of Terry. Now Terry was looking at Sarah like, oh, you just saved my life. Terry couldn't believe it. After how mean he's been to poor Sarah, Sarah still helped him. Now, obviously, he had hurt his ankle, so he needed help to get home. Sarah, with all the strength she could muster, lifted up Terry onto her shoulders, and they waddled together. He was leaning on her, and she helped him to get to his house, which was across the way from hers. And when she got there, she said, Terry, I hope you feel better soon. And she knocked on the door, and she told his mom and dad what happened to him, and they were ever so grateful of Sarah. Now, Sarah didn't stay and she didn't try to, you know, go into the house because she was scared herself. She just wanted to go home and it was coming up to Sabbath anyway. So she went to church as you do on Sabbath. And then she came and she was going home on Sunday, getting ready for school on Monday. They had just finished half term. And she was praying to God and she was saying, God, I've got another term of school left. And these boys and girls are so mean to me. I wonder how it will go down when I go back to school. So on Monday morning, she arrived for school. And lo and behold, Terry was there. Terry greeted her at the door and was so sorry. He was like, I'm so sorry, Sarah, for being so mean to you. I should never have done those things. And when the other children saw this, they were all very perplexed. What do you think perplexed means? Let me see. Think again, let's see.
Puzzled.
They were very confused. They were perplexed. So they couldn't understand it. And at break time, the other children tried to make fun of Sarah. And they were pulling at her hair and calling her names and being horrible. But Terry saw this. He stood up and said, stop. Don't be mean to Sarah. You guys left me when I fell over and I hurt my leg. You never came back for me. She was the only one who came back for me to make sure I was safe. Yeah? And from that day forth, none of the other children ever bothered Sarah again. So you see how taking care of those around you, even when they're being mean to you, it's a good thing to do, and that's what Jesus would have us to do. Amen? I also want to ask you, what do you think Sarah could have done differently? If someone's making fun of you at school or they're making you feel bad on the inside and they're not being nice, what do you think you should do?
Tell a teacher or your parent.
Exactly. So if someone's making you feel upset and you don't like what they're doing, so you need to tell a teacher, tell someone that you respect and that you trust, tell someone safe, yeah? Don't suffer in silence, okay? All right, so that's the end of our story today. I hope you've learned something. And remember, love your enemies and pray for those who treat you badly, because we can be an example of Jesus to them and help and encourage them to do better. So who would like to pray for us today? Yes, you would like to pray? Anyone else? You want to come and pray? Sure. What's your name?
Peter.
Say it again.
Peter.
Okay, Peter's going to pray and?
Travon.
Travon is going to pray. Peter, let's pray.
Our Father Jesus, help me that we go to school on time tomorrow. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for that prayer, Peter.
Jesus, please bless me. Thank you, Lord, for taking this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the whole children. Thank you, Lord, for the be kind. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, boys and girls. You listen very well. You can go back to your seats.
It's now time for prayer. We're going to sing hymn 260, Hover O'er Me, Holy Spirit. We're going to sing the chorus twice, so feel free to kneel or come up if you want to for the prayer.
possible. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your loving kindness and your protection. We thank you for waking us up this morning and bringing us here this morning. We thank you for the traveling mercies, Father. We lift up our eyes onto the hills from whence cometh our help, for our help coming from the Lord who created the heavens and the earth. Father, you stand there and time revolves around you. At the blast of your breath, we can see the foundations of the earth and the bottom of the sea. You sit in heaven where your throne is, and earth is your footstool. The clouds are like dust unto your feet. For there is none like unto you. Your name is Jehovah Shabaoth, the Lord of hosts, the head of the angelic armies. Father, this morning we come to you with thanksgiving, with praise in our hearts. We come before you because we recognize that indeed you are the creator of all things. We bless your name and we praise you, Father God. We ask that, Father, this morning that you remember, Lord, the people in Aleppo, in Mosul, in other parts of the world where there is pain and suffering, where there is war, Lord. We pray, Lord, and we lift their children and their victims of the wars, Lord, into your hands. For we know you are the only one who can bring comfort to them. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that indeed you are still on the throne. Father, we pray that you help us, Lord, to recognize that indeed the devil tos and froes like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. He comes to us in subtle ways, Father. Help us, Father, to be able to decipher, Lord, truth from error. Father, we present to you the children, Lord, the youth of this church. Father, we know that the mind is the battlefield and the devil, Lord, is doing everything that he can, Lord. He's trying to sift us like wheat, Father, because he wants to destroy us. Father, we take comfort, Lord, and we bring your word to remembrance that says that indeed, Lord, you make us co-heirs of the kingdom. We know that indeed your word tells us that, Father, all things work together for good for those who love the Lord and are called according to his purposes, and that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Father, your word also tells us that indeed you know the purpose you have for us. Your purpose for us is to prosper us and give us an expected end, and not plans of evil. So we thank you for that, Lord. We pray, Father God, that you be with this neighborhood, Lord. We be with the church in this neighborhood. Let us be a light, Lord, in this community. We pray for the homes in this community, Father God, that whatever people are going through, that, Lord, you will be with them. Be with us, Lord, as we prepare to go out this afternoon to meet, Lord, the people in the community. Help us, Father God, that indeed, Lord, when we go, indeed, it is you who will shine, not us. We pray that indeed, Lord, you help us to bear fruit, good fruit. Lord, help us to recognize that indeed you've given us all talents, spiritual talents, and help us, Lord, not to be idle people in your vineyard, Lord, and not to be found wanting, but Father, to use the talent you've blessed us with in a way that, Lord, will glorify your name. We pray, Father God, that you be with the speaker of this hour, that indeed, Lord, his word will come from you, that whatever he speaks, Lord, to be not his word, but your word. Father, we pray for our pastor, Lord, and his family as well. We pray that you, Lord, you build a wall of fire around our pastor, Lord, and the leadership of this church, Father God, that indeed, Lord, they will lead the flock in the right direction. Father, I thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done for us. We pray that, Lord, at the end of the day, Lord, whatever we'll do, Lord, we'll remember that indeed, Lord, it's not us, but you, Lord, and that you've won the battle for us, and that we ought to give glory to you, Lord, no matter our circumstances. We pray, Father God, that whatever is going to be collected today, Lord, will be used to further your work. We pray that those who will give you, bless them, and those who are not able to give you, bless them equally. We thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done for us as a church. We pray that, Lord, you continue to abide with us and let us abide with you. We ask these and many other blessings in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Thy substance and with the first fruits of all thy increase, so shall thy barns be filled with plenty. and the presses shall burst out with new wine. Divine wisdom has appointed in the plan of salvation, the law of action and reaction, making the work of beneficence in all its branches twice blessed. He who gives to the needy blesses others, and is blessed himself in a still greater degree. When we give to the Lord's cause, we make an investment into the kingdom and the souls gathered into its borders and blessed with eternal life. They are our results and our reward. Today, as we honor God for his goodness towards us, by the gifts we bring to him, we engage in the work of salvation through the blessings he has bestowed upon us, and by extension, we are blessed and the cycle begins again. Give, don't stop the blessings flowing. The deacons and deaconesses will wait on us for a tithes and free will offering.
We sing, give thanks with a grateful heart.
Now, and now, let the weak say. verses 1 to 6. St. John chapter 9, verse 1 to 6. And Jesus passed by. He saw a man which was blind from his birth. And his disciple asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, Neither have this man sinned nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. I must work the work of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And when he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spat, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with clay. This is the word of God.
The privilege is mine this morning to introduce our preacher for the day. But before I do that, I need to just say a word to welcome some of the people that I see that I know. I see many of you I don't know, but I know today that in this congregation I have my brother Ernil and his wife Millie. Welcome to Balham today. And Aunt Elma, your mom is here, 95 years of age. Welcome from New York, Aunt Elma. Good to see you. Here she is from New York. Welcome, welcome. And we have in the congregation also my sister Joycelyn, who's your former member. Joycelyn Samuels, she's right there. Welcome from New York as well. Good to see you. And then beside Joycelyn, we have my cousin Elaine. First time visiting England. First time. Glad to have you with us, Elaine. And of course, thank God he's kept you, Aunt Elma. God bless you. All right, and of course, you know, my mother is here. Glad to have her, who's 93 going into 94. Praise God, thank God for that. And of course, last but not least, I must remind you too that my wife Pam is here. And Pam, glad to have you, and you know, we're glad to be here with you today. What can I say about the preacher who is with us today? I could say to you that this preacher, I met him over 30 years ago, and when I met him, I realized then that he was a vibrant, committed, excited young man, a member of the Palm Seventh-day Adventist Church, Logantown, Liberia. When I met him, some people asked me, is he your son? I said, well, could have been, but you know, let's say he's a brother, because he had the same name. I could tell you that as we moved together, the Liberian Mission of Seventh-day Adventists recognized that in this young man were so many good talents that they gave him a little stipend and asked him to go into an area a little out of town where there was a village where the people were Muslim, and he worked there with them with a school program and evangelistic outreach, baptizing some of their people there in that village. I could tell you also that he left Liberia and went to Jamaica just about the same time as Hurricane Gilbert. Although he didn't devastate Jamaica, he really tried to improve things there. He attended then West Indies College, now Northern Caribbean University. And I could tell you also that he graduated from there with a degree in theology. And then he came back to England, attended Newbold College, graduated with a master's degree. He also got a law degree from Wolverhampton. I could tell you that he's also married, and his wife Barbara and their children are here. They have three children here today, and I'd like them to just greet us. There's Barbara, there's Nathaniel, there's Enoch, and there's where are you? Oh, right here. Okay, we're glad that you're all here with us. And there's Barbara, and there's Enoch, and there's Nathaniel, and Luther. Yes, I can't forget Martin Luther, the great leader. Yes, we're glad that you're here. Our preacher today also studied at Andrews University, where he graduated with the Doctor of Ministry degree, his terminal degree. He's back here in England with us. He has pastored in churches like Stratford and Stoke Newington. And recently, he has been appointed by the South England Conference as the Family Ministries Director. It should not surprise you that this young man with his talents and skills, has been able to be used by God all over this country and different parts of the world in doing great things. And so today it is my privilege to introduce to you Dr. Augustus Kafuma Lawrence. Indeed, he's my brother, because his name is Lawrence. He's a spirit-filled preacher of the Word of God. He's one who knows how to share God's Word to God's people. So after the music of meditation that is going to be presented today by Brother Theon Flood, the next voice that you're going to hear is going to be the voice of Dr. Pastor Augustus Lawrence. I trust that the Word of the Lord through him today, God's mouthpiece speaking to us today, he will not only comfort the distressed, but he'll also distress the comfortable. We're going to have a prayer for him this morning, and Pastor is going to lead out in that as we pray with him before he presents the word and before the music man comes and sings for us as we bring the word of God through Dr. Augustus Lawrence.
We want to say a special prayer for Pastor Lawrence and the family. We'd like to invite them to come forward. We have a tradition in this church where we love to pray for families. It's catching up. So every time we have families visiting with us, we would like to just extend a special prayer for them. Nathaniel is out. Join with me as we bow our heads for prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the honor and privilege of being members of your family. And today we bring the Lawrence family to you. In a special way, we dedicate them to you, that your protection will be upon them, your blessings will be upon them. As they serve you, Lord, they would need your added protection against all the schemes of the evil one, and they need your anointing in their lives. So, Father, we pray that special blessing upon them. Grant them health, grant them strong faith, and Lord, if there be anything in their lives that is unlike you, we pray that you would reverse it. Even today, as they step forward to serve, we pray that the double anointing of your spirit will be upon your manservant. And even, Lord, we thank you that he has been called to serve on a larger scale as our family life director at the conference. Even for this, we thank you and pray your special blessing on his life. For us, Lord, as a church, may we continue to be grateful to receive that which you skill and equip your leaders with to serve us. This is our humble prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Good afternoon, church. Hi. It's good to be here in the house of the Lord. The song that I'm going to minister to you today is a song of faith. We've been looking at Job recently for Sabbath school. Anyone? Yeah. And for me, the thing that I've taken from it is about faith. And I pray that each and every day, our faith grows day to day. Amen. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning. With thee, thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest.
rest. Sun, moon, and stars in their courses above join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Oh, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Lord, your strength for today and bright hopes for tomorrow. Your blessings all mine with 10,000s beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Thank you for singing. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath, everybody. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You can smile a little bit. You can smile a little bit and show your smiling faces. And you all look so beautiful, handsome, and pretty. And God is good. Amen.
Amen.
This church has been a blessing in my life. And I want to acknowledge that. I have had done so in the past. I want to do so again. But firstly, I want to thank you, Doc, for the warm introduction. And I want to thank my brother and friend, my colleague in ministry, Pastor Dr. Emmanuel Michael Mbui, for the warm introduction and welcome and invitation. And all of you, I see some people that I have known for a very long time. I think it's now 28 years since I came here, the first time I came here to Balam. Yes, September 12, 1988. Amen. Amen. You remember them days? I haven't seen it. Amen. But then there were so many good people. I remember, I came that Wednesday. It was cold. Lord, never felt so cold in my life before. But then she took me down to the Jamaican High Commission. Then I think it was Green Park Station, Piccadilly. Then it was somewhere there. And I said, no, you can't go because Gilbert just struck. So I ended up staying with Mom for 6 months. I remember the Friday, she gave me some red pea soup. Lord, have mercy. And, you know, I coming from back in West Africa, I've never seen, heard, or tasted red pea soup before in my life. And I didn't like it. I didn't like red pea soup. But she said, eat it, son, eat it. Good for you. She said, eat it. Red pea soup with dumplings and everything else. I didn't like it, but I got used to it. And I still love it today. And Mom has been a mother to me. My family has been a mother to me. And I want to thank you for that, Mom. You're still alive. And I want to thank you for all the things you've done for me over the years when I was at college. Sometimes, you know, when you're in Mandeville and things, excuse my language, things are rough, you know? And then a letter comes through, and there's a £20 in there. You know, it meant a lot. It meant a lot. And she was with me throughout, and still is. Rough times. There were some pretty rough times, too. I don't know about you, but there were some pretty rough times. And she was with me. The Lord took me through. And today I'm standing here. It's not because of anything that I've had. I want to let you know that I ain't got nothing. But God has been with me. Amen. And I have felt his hands all these many years leading me. And so, Mom, I want to thank you. I want to thank you. May God bless you and your family. And I want to thank Balaam Church also. Sister Bernard. Sister Bernard still here? Yes. Sister Sylvia. She used to come. You feel pray, you know? You want to pray, you know, son? Pray. We met. I remember the hall, I think, was Masonic building was there, and the first Wednesday night, Elder Henry was there, and Brother Pete, the late Brother Pete, and Elder, forgotten his name now. He was there with us. Elder Moncrief was there. Mumfries was there, and all of those wonderful people. Balaam has been a wonderful place, and still is. And we moved. I went to St. Paul's. You remember those days?
Yes.
And we're there at St. Paul's, and then the place was built, and then we came back. And we're still here.
Yes.
There's some folk are still here. Some have passed on, waiting for the Lord in His. For him to come. I want to thank all of you who's been instrumental, praying for me one way or the other, seen me in and prayed for me and encouraged me. I want to thank you all. I want to thank you, Palm. Thank you. You've known me long before I know myself. Came to Liberia. I want to talk from my heart this afternoon. I won't keep you long. Somebody said to me that when he preached long at Balaam, and I said, there's a hole somewhere. said somebody will press a button and you will. Well, I won't keep you long. Amen. The sermon I had, I've changed it over the last few minutes. I've changed it to a sermon that I've preached before. In fact, I think I preached it last week. There's a reason why I want to preach it. As I looked around, this afternoon, as I looked at some faces that I've known over the years, there are some that I don't see anymore. Some worked very hard for this place. Some of them didn't get to enjoy the blessings that you are enjoying this afternoon. A lot of sweat, blood, crying, fussing, cussing, excuse me. Yeah, some of you cursed. Be honest. True, isn't it? Yeah. Some of you left home. Some of you got high blood pressure. Some of you got all kinds of illnesses because the project wasn't coming through. Some of you got angry. But you know, the thing is, we all go into the kingdom. Amen. And it was a battle, but thank God. So I look around today. Some of you came to church. I'm not sure why you came. I suspect that you came to hear a word from the Lord. And some of you might be discouraged. Some of you this afternoon, you were here, but somehow about to maybe throw the towel in and give up. You don't understand why things has been the way they are and why you have been experiencing life as it is for you. Somehow you're here this morning and you're asking questions and there are burdens on your heart, and you have been carrying this burden over the long period of time, and you may have been asking questions. Why? Why? There is a little book in the Old Testament, a minor prophet, that I want to share with you. Three chapters. The book of Habakkuk. In fact, it says in verse 1 that the prophet had a burden. He had a burden. And I want to let you know that Christians also carry burdens. And sometimes those burdens are so heavy that sometimes they do not know how to offload those burdens. Life is full of burdens. I want to let you know, if you think that life doesn't have burdens and problems, I've come to remind you this afternoon that life is compact and full and pressed together with burdens. Some of those burdens you and I will carry until Jesus comes. So it says in verse 1 that the prophet Habakkuk had a burden. So let me ask you this afternoon, what burdens are you carrying? What burdens did you come with this morning to church? Maybe there's an illness you're struggling with, and maybe you have been struggling with your illness for a given number of years. And you've been to the doctors and the medical has not been able to resolve your burden. Maybe there is a burden with you as an individual. There is some confusion maybe in your head. Maybe there is something you haven't been able to resolve and you're struggling with it. There is a confusion, the cognitive dissonance in your head you're carrying. Maybe there's problem in your home, maybe with a spouse. Maybe your home has become the place that the devil has taken over. Maybe your children have become a source that the devil has used and continues to use to inflict pain and agony in your life, and you're wondering how come your own children, whom you've brought up in God, have become a tool in the hand of the enemy. And you're carrying this burden this morning, maybe it's an illness, some kind of burden that you may be carrying this afternoon, and you've been struggling with it, and you haven't been able to resolve it all, to offload that burden. You're here this morning. Something must have brought you here this morning, despite of your burden. And you are here. And thank God that you are here, amen. Amen. So the prophet had a burden. And then in verse 2, he cries out. He cries out to God. In verse 2, he cries out and he says, Lord, I want you to notice before he says how long, I want you to notice the first two words in verse 2. He uses some words I want to talk about a little bit. Can I talk about those words? He says, oh, there's a distance between, in practical life, in life itself, brothers and sisters, there's a distance between the old and the Lord. There's a distance. This is the cry of God's people. This is the cry of God's people throughout the ages when they felt his apparent absence or silence. When God becomes inactive, when it feels as if to say God has left you to deal with your problems by yourself. You know what I'm talking about? And so he's crying out. He says, oh Lord, I remember when you know, I was told this story. We grew up in one room. I don't know about you, but where I come from, we had one room. Are you listening to me? How many rooms did I say?
One.
One room. And my mother slept on that side of the room, and we slept on this side. And we had mice. You know what I mean, mice? No, you call them rats. We call them rats, not mice. Mice is the little ones, but we call them rats. And those rats, they have the capacity to bite and blow. You don't know what I'm talking about. They used to eat our feet, right? They used to eat our, they used to bite. They have a way that when they bite you, so you wouldn't feel it. You only feel it the next morning when you wake up, you see the blood on the bed, you want to huck up. You look, rats have come. So sometimes the rats used to wake us up. But when I woke up, I also was waking up to the sound of my mother. She used to make some noises at 3 a.m. in the morning. I never understood what she was talking about because she used to talk in our language. She used to talk a kind of a language that I did not understand until I became an adult and I asked her. And I said, Mom, you remember those days you used to wake us up like 3 o'clock in the morning? What do you used to talk about? What so much, Mom, that 3 a.m. in the morning you talking? When people are sleeping, you talking? And she had a big voice, you know. She had a big voice. Then she explained to me, and she said, you know, there were 6 of you. 5 boys, 1 girl. She said there were 6 of you, and many times I didn't have food for you all. She said, I didn't know where food was going to come from the next day. Because my father had a lot of children. He has 17 of us. Hey. So she said, many times I did not know how I was going to provide for you. So 3 o'clock in the morning, she said, I will fall on my knees and I will call on to God and ask him to make provision. So that oh Lord is the song that you and I sing. I need the oh, I need thee every now. I need thee, oh bless me now, my Savior. I come two. I need the oh, I need that oh Lord is a cry when my mother felt that God had forsaken her, that God wasn't answering her prayer, that God had distanced himself from her, that he was no longer close to her. She felt as if to say God had taken up his residence in his kingdom and forgotten about her. And you know, here in this life, we feel like that sometimes, don't you? When there is no job, you can't find a job to pay the expenses for your home or your children, your family. You feel that way sometimes. When there's an illness, went to a mother, went to see a sister a couple of Fridays ago. You know, Friday nights. One of the nights I don't like to go out, but Barbara's asked me, where are you going Friday night? And I can't tell her when I'm going, you know. I'm going to see somebody that's sick that has cancer of the kidney. And I can't tell you I'm going to see somebody that has, you know. So just let me, my sister now, let me go and see the sister now. But I went to see this sister. She said, Augustus, I don't understand why all these years I've been doing what God has asked me to do. I have walked with him. I have loved him all my life. How do I get now this illness? How do I justify this illness? She says to me. I do justify it. The prophet says, what time are you finish? Yeah. I haven't gone anywhere yet. 2 o'clock. Yeah. 1 o'clock. All right. So verse 2, let me see. Lord, how long will I cry? So he felt God's absence. He says his first problem was he didn't understand why God is absent from his presence. He didn't understand the absence of God. And not only was God absent, but God was also silent. He said not only is God absent, he said he's also silent. And not only that, not only is he absent, not only is he silent, but he's not doing anything. Verse 3. He says, I don't understand. All around me is the severity of wickedness. He said, all around me I see problems. I see, verse 3, he said, why doth thou show me iniquity? He said, all around me I see iniquity. Sin has increased. He said, all around me I just see problems and problems and problems. And I'm asking you, why haven't you done something? You know something? I wish I had time to catalog all of the problems we have in our society, the wickedness, and how they are just increasing from, you know, it's almost, Ellen White says, that God is gradually but surely withdrawing his spirit from the earth in these last days. He says in verse 4, the Lord is slack. Everything is problem around me. In verse 5, he says the problem continues. And then God gives a response to Habakkuk. He said, listen, Habakkuk, listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. Yo, he says to Habakkuk. Listen, boy. He says in verse 5, he says, last part of verse 5, for I will work a work in your days, when ye, that which ye will not believe, though it were told you. He says, God, I'm this thing, this problem, and that other problem. God says, hey, I'm working it out. That if I told you what I'm going to do, you wouldn't believe it. So God told him what he's going to do. Verse 6. God said, you know what I'm going to do, Habakkuk? Listen. He said, you see those wicked people? I'm going to use them to whip you. So in other words, Those people who don't keep Sabbath, those people who don't know God, he says, I'm going to use them to whip all of you here in this place. I'm going to use the wicked as a tool, as an instrument to inflict pain on you. Rebecca says, what? You mean those terrible Chaldeans, those wicked people, God says? He said, yes, those wicked people, I'm going to use them. Then that raised another problem for Habakkuk. He said, no. Verse 12, he said, no, God. He says in verse 12, he says, God, you are a holy God. How are you going to use something that is unrighteous? How are you going to come and identify and touch something that is unholy? He said, no, nothing doesn't go, nothing goes like this. You mean you're going to use those wicked people? God said, yes, I'm going to do that. He says, no, in verse 13, he said, God, you're too holy, you're too righteous. You're not going to use holy, you're not going to touch. He said, no, that's too much. No, that doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense, Habakkuk. Now, he's telling God, you know, the creature is telling God, that doesn't make sense. God says, I'm going to use the Chaldeans, these wicked people, to inflict pain on you. He's telling God, it doesn't make sense. How are you, holy God, can use wickedness? He said, no. So when he talks in chapter 2, verse 1, he says, here's what I'm going to do. He says, here I'm going to do. He says, I'm going to keep quiet. I'm going to watch and see what God is going to do. Verse 2, chapter 2, verse 1, he says, I'm going to watch and see. So God comes back to him. Verse 2, God says, Habakkuk, here's what I want you to do. He says, Habakkuk, I want you to take a pen. I want you to take a paper. And I want you to write this down. I want you to write this down so that people in Balaam Church, October 29th, 2016, when they read it, they will understand. Those who are living, who lived before, who are living now, and who will live in the future, they will have to understand that. They will have to understand this, that. Verse 5, they have to understand this. Verse 4, they have to understand this. Write this. And let them understand this, that those who will live in 2016, those who will live before 2016 and live during 2016, I want you to listen to this. Habakkuk, I want you to write this down. I want you to write this down so that they will not forget, so that they will have it as evidence that those, I want you to hear this. If you don't hear anything today, hear this. Those who are living before 2016. Now, let me ask you here. Have you all lived before 2016? Yes, you have. Those who lived before 2016. Those who are living during 2016. And those who will live after 2016 will have to understand this. That they would have to live not by what they see. Their eyes, they will understand. They will have to live by not what they see, but have to live by faith. Amen. Because you know what? What you see will discourage you. What we're going to see in these final hours of earth history will discourage us. It'll be so discouraging. You look in the church, you'll see all kinds of stuff. You didn't hear that, did you? You will look in the church and you'll see all kinds of stuff happening. I wish I could catalog some of the stuff. You'll get discouraged even before it begins to happen. He says, those who are living in the last days will have to understand that they have to live by faith. Then Habakkuk says, but Lord, what about all these wicked people? What's going to happen to them? God says, Habakkuk, listen to me. I'll give you five things that are going to happen to them. He gave him five woes. Verse 6, there's a woe. Verse 9, there is a second. Verse 12, there's another one. Verse 15, there's another one. Verse 19, there's another one. He said, you see those wicked people? I have them on the racks. Don't worry about them. You see all those people?
who you envy in and you think that things going fine for them. He says, don't worry, God says to Habakkuk, I have them in under wraps. Habakkuk complained, and God had to say to him in verse 20, Habakkuk, be quiet, boy. Because I'm the sovereign God, I'm in control. He says, I'm in control. He says, Habakkuk, stop complaining. Stop complaining about your pain. Stop complaining about your misfortunes. Stop complaining about your problems. Because as the sovereign God, I am in control. I am the God of the universe. I'm not confused. I'm not taken by surprise. I know what I'm doing. Yes, there is evil. Yes, there is pain. But I know what I'm doing. But he says to the prophet, the Lord is in his holy temple. You know, he's not talking about the church, you know. He's not talking about people being silent in the church. No, no, that's not what he's talking about. No, no, no. He's talking about the problems of life. You and I ought to trust him because he says to us, we must keep what? Silent. Then Habakkuk now decides, now he moves from doubt. He moves now to faith. Chapter 3, verse 17. Here's this guy now who was complaining, verse 1. Chapter 1 and verse 1, you see this guy who was complaining and making all these noises? Yes. He moved now from doubt to having a solid faith in God. Chapter 3, verse 17. Here's what he said. Listen to him now. He's talking now. He said, although the fig tree shall not do what? Blossom. He said, neither shall there the fruit be in the vines. He said, the labor of the olive shall fail. The field shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stall. You know what he's talking about? You know what he's talking about? Oh, Lord. You know what he's talking about? He says, even though I may have nothing to eat, even though I may have no job, even though things will be rough with me and my family, even though the seas are going to be rough, God says, here's what I'm going to do. He says in verse 18, he said, yet, now he didn't say they, you know, he said, yet, I. He used the personal pronoun, I. He said, yet I would rejoice. You see, rejoicing in the Lord in time of uncertainties is a recipe for strength. It's not rejoicing in God during the time of adversity is a recipe to help us navigate through the problems of life. When we're having problems, we ought to learn that being joyful, rejoicing. He says, even though I have not all these things, I will rejoice in the Lord. He says, not only will I rejoice, he says, I will joy in the God of my salvation. And finally, he makes this confession. He says, the Lord God is my strength. Did he see that? Oh, Lord, I wish I had time to talk about that. He said, Lord God is my strength. And he will, here's what God will do for you. Listen to me. Habakkuk was looking for words to explain what God is going to do for him in his problems of need. He says, in his time of need, the Lord God is my strength. He says, and he will make my feet like what? You know what that, you know, why does the prophet use those words? In the lines, it's a red deer, female. It has the capacity to navigate terrestrial shoals. You know, that animal has the capacity to run on a surface that are rough and slippery and sticky and difficult. That animal has the capacity not only to ride, but to ride, run above those. In other words, what Habakkuk is saying, that God will do for you, God will not take away the problems. He will not take the difficult times from our lives. No, he says you and I will have to go through, but God will give you and I, he will give you and me the capacity to navigate through them. Amen. He says, I will make your feet like hinds' feet, and he will make me to walk upon the what? The high places. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Make you to walk upon the high places. This is what he's going to do for you. And so this morning, I don't know how things are with you, but God said, here's my promise. He said, I'm going to make your feet like hinds' feet. So I'm going to make you to ride on the high places of the world. See, this is what I do. He says, it is impossible for me to lie. He said, if I were to lie, I would cease to be God. He says, I will allow you to walk upon high places in the midst of your problems, in the midst of your situation. I will allow you to walk above. I don't know about you this morning, this afternoon, but I want him to make my feet like hinds' feet. Is that your desire? Yes. Is it your desire? Yes. I want you to stand where you are. If you want the Lord to make your feet like hinds' feet, allow you to walk upon high places, these are his words. You and I in these days will learn to lean on Jesus. Learn to lean on Jesus. Hallelujah. Our Father in heaven, we come this afternoon thanking you for the assurance and the promise that you will never distance yourself from us. You promised to be with us. And he said, you'll make our feet like hinds' feet. You'll allow us to ride upon the high places of the earth. So Lord, teach us to rejoice in you. Teach us to be joyful. I don't know what problems the people may have this morning, what burden they may have, but we come to the cross. But in the cross, we find strength and courage to face the future, to face the unknown. And so, Lord, this afternoon, we just give ourselves to you. We've tried by ourselves. We fought and tried by ourselves in our own strength, and we failed. So we're just turning it all over to you now. We put our trust in you. Whatever happens to us, Lord, we know that our lives are in your hands. And we ask you to strengthen us. We will remain faithful even when times are difficult. We trust you anyhow. As we stand today, we are indicating to you that our hope and our trust is in you. It's none other we know. We ask you to do that which only you alone can do for us. For we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
We're going to sing our closing song, God Is. Short of his word. I'm gonna fast and pray. stay in the narrow way. Keep my life clean every day. I want to go with him when he comes back. I've come too far and I'll never turn back. The top. God is the strength. God is the joy and the strength of my life.
God is the joy and the strength of my life.
Pain, misery, and strife.
He
promised to lead me. Never to leave me. He's never ever fallen short of his word. I'm gonna fast and pray. Stay in the narrow way. My life.
Every day.
I want to go with him when he comes back.
I've come
too far and I'll never turn back.
Father, we thank you today for your blessings and the promise we have in you, the sovereign God who's in charge, who's in control. Into your hands we leave our lives. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his Father, with explicit joy, may his power, dominion, and authority now rest with us. And let all of God's people say, amen, amen and amen.
We're going to sing that one more time from the top. God is, as the platform party leaves.
God is, oh God is, oh God is, oh God is.
seated and the ushers will show you out.